Hello everyone, my name is Sachin Mahendra Redia. One of the basic qualifications that I have is that I'm a cybercrime investigator, also a certified ethical hacker. The certification is given by EC Council USA. The main topic which we'll be covering today is IT security in a CA's office. And under that, we will be covering two main topics, that is concepts of internet protocol and Wi-Fi security. When we talk about Wi-Fi security, in a real life, we'll try to understand as to how does our Wi-Fi works. And one of the major queries of everyone is that they want to know how many people are connected onto their Wi-Fi, onto their internet. So today, from a real life point of view, I'll be explaining the concepts of IP and also how do you secure your Wi-Fi and actually find out how many people are connected to your Wi-Fi. Okay. The first topic which I'll be covering is IP, that is Internet Protocol. And we will try to understand what you mean by IP and the various features or the classifications of an IP address. For anyone to understand how the internet works, he needs to understand the concept of IP. So we'll just try and cover this particular topic. Right now, we are on IP4. The version that we are using is IP4. So all computers connected to the internet have a unique number, usually called as an IP address. It basically identifies every computer on the internet. So IP4 is consisting of four numbers, which are going to be separated by three dots. And the range of every number will always, and I mean always, be in the range of 0 to 255. And IP4 range cannot exceed beyond 255. So a simple example of an IP is like this: 210.214.172.18. So this is basically what we mean by an IP4. It will consist of four numbers which are going to be separated by three dots, and it individually identifies every computer on the internet, and the range of every number is between 0 to 255. The next version, logically thinking, people would assume that since we are on IP4, the next version would be IP5, but actually IP5 has been skipped and directly IP6 has been launched, which I'll be covering that part also. Now we move on to the IP address classification types. So here we have various types of classifications of IP. So we have an internal IP, we'll have an external IP, we have a public IP, we have a private IP, we are on IP4, next version which is going to be launched is IP6, and we have a static IP and we have a dynamic IP. Looks confusing, but I will try and simplify this as much as possible. So what I'll do is I'll just explain you the concept of an internal IP first. For that, okay, now how do we find out an internal IP of our computer? So for that, what we need to do is we need to press the Windows button and we press the R button, that is Windows Run, from a command prompt. We are basically trying to go into the command prompt. So here either we'll write CMD or we can write command. Normally people would prefer typing CMD, and we will go inside the command prompt itself. Here we need to write down ipconfig. This is the command that we need to put up, ipconfig. And once we put up that particular thing, we press enter. We just go on to the top. You will see this Windows IP configuration which has been given over there. And here it shows IP address. If you can see the IP address over here, it is 10.0.36.222. This is our internal IP, IP4 address. And we also have something known as a default gateway, which I'll be covering under Wi-Fi security. But this is our internal IP of the computer, IP4 address 10.0.36.22. Similarly, if we are connected in a network, every computer onto our network will always have a different IP4, that is a different internal IP. Now, if you want to have a little bit of a mischief, if you want to do a little bit of a fun inside your office, what you can basically do is you can find out the internal IP of any of your colleagues who are within the same network, that is, who are sitting in your own office. Take out the IP address. So mostly it will be 10.0.36 point. The last digit will change over here. Or it will be in 192.168.1, or it will be 172 or something. Find out the internal IP address of your colleague. Come to the command prompt. And there, you write down one command known as shutdown. You just write down a command known as shutdown, space, minus M, stands for machine, space, minus R, that is for restart, space. You need to give the IP address of your victim, or you can say the target or your colleague, except yours. If you give your own IP, you will end up shutting down or restarting your own computer itself, which you probably don't want to do. So what we'll do is, we'll take out the IP address, say 10.0.36 point, any IP address of your colleague, so I'm just saying 224, okay, and if you end up pressing enter, chances are, if remote connections are enabled on that particular computer, that computer will end up getting shut down or you will get restart. So the victim or your colleague will not even come to know why his computer is getting shut down or is getting restarted. This is basically to find out, this is how we can actually use, you know, the concept of an internal IP. Of course, the practical usage will be known to you later on. But this is what an IP for internal IP consists of. Now, for a non-IT person or a non-technical person, maybe a command line does not sound that interesting. So what we need to do is, I will give you another command over here, that is shutdown space minus I. Shutdown space minus I. This will actually take you into a graphical user interface, GUI. Graphical user interface, which will allow you to remotely shut down any person's computer who is within your LAN. Mind well, this will help you to shut down any person's computer provided he is within your own network, that is within your LAN or within your Wi-Fi. How do you configure this particular thing, or how do you activate, or how do you execute this thing? So once you see the computers, click on add. You will need to give the computer name of your victim or your colleague, or you will need to give the internal IP of your colleague. So basically 10.36.225, something like that. Just initially find out your victim or your colleague's internal IP, put in the IP address over there, and I mean the internal IP. You click on OK, and you will see that particular thing coming up over here. Now, what you exactly want to do with that particular computer? Whether you want to shut down or would you like to have a restart. So you can choose the options out of those two. Maybe we just click on restart. Then, do you want to warn the user? That is something known as quick ping of death, or some, if you don't want to warn the users, it will instantly restart the person's computer. If you want to warn the users, you need to give them the time frame, so you can say 60 seconds. So on the victim's computer, a warning would be displayed saying that after 60 seconds, his computer is going to be shut down or is going to be restarted. And we can even write a comment. Comment in the sense, we can write, save your work, or you can say, you got hacked. Very simple name like tada bye bye or something like that. You press OK. I'm not going to press OK, otherwise somebody else in my network would get restarted over here. But if you end up pressing on OK, very good chance is that your victim or your colleague's computer will show a message something like this onto that particular screen, and after 60 seconds, his computer is going to be restarted. The thing why I'm showing you this particular reason, or why I'm particularly showing this particular steps, is this is from a point of view of a security audit. So whenever we go and do a systems audit, or we conduct a security audit of any network, we first try to find out all the internal IPs of that particular network, and we try and execute this particular shutdown command so as to find out whether the computers are vulnerable and they can be brought down from remotely or not. So in a way, if somebody comes within your LAN, he can actually shut down the admin's PC, he can shut down the firewall's PC, and then he can do all the necessary things which a hacker or anybody else who has a malicious intentions within your network to do that particular thing. So this is the concept of IP address for, I mean, this is internal IP. Now, we move on to something known as static IP and something known as dynamic IP. Static, which means your IP will remain constant no matter whether the user disconnects or reconnects to the internet. Dynamic, which means changes every time the user logs onto the internet. For a simple way, what I'm going to show you is, how do you find out your IP? For what you need to do, if you're not sure what to do, just press IP and you press enter. Or you need to go into Google. Or there are various such websites. The very popular website to find out your external IP is who.is. So if you come on to this website who.is, you see that your IP address is given over here. Now this is our external IP, an IP which has been provided by our service provider. So it can be Vodafone, Reliance, BSNL, MTNL, or any other service provider which you're using. Now, how to find out this IP belongs to which service provider? So when we go on to this website, it gives us this IP. Just go and click on that IP. Another way, as I said, you go on to Google. Just write IP over there and you press enter. You see, this is what it's going to explain, the IP concepts and everything like that. Actually, giving us IP also. And over here, who.is, I went and clicked on that website, clicked on that IP. It is going to give us all the detailed information as to from which is our service provider. So if you can see over here, we have taken our internet from Reliance Communications. So our service provider is nothing but Reliance Communications itself. Now, here is the details of the service provider. So you will see the address, you will see the email IDs. You can even get their mobile numbers, their phone numbers, their fax numbers, and every other detail. Mind well, this is the detail of the service provider from where we have taken the internet connection. And this is nothing but our external IP. Now, next day, when you come on, and when you execute the same exercise again, if your IP changes, so I'll just come over here and execute this particular thing. If your IP changes every day, which means you are on a dynamic IP. So next day when you switch off your router and you switch on the internet again, if your external IP keeps on changing, which means we are on a dynamic IP. If your IP is more or less the same, then it is nothing but a static IP. To explain the concept in a much better manner, I'll just use Excel for this particular thing. Let us take a simple example over here. This is our IP. We click on this particular thing. Now, let us assume Reliance has taken this entire series 115.249.118. Reliance has bought this series, so I'll just say Reliance 115.249.131 from 0 to 255. He has actually bought out the entire series of this particular IP range, which means Reliance can give internet connections to almost 255 people because it has bought that particular series, it has got that particular range of series. So assuming a person tries to log on to the Reliance internet connection at 10.1, so Reliance might give him an IP 115.249.131. Reliance might not give him 0 and 1 and the last two series 254, 255. it might have been reserved. Many ISP service providers will do that. So it might give him an IP 2. Assuming one more person logs on, say, at 10.3, so Reliance will give him an IP 115.249.141.3. One person will log on, say, at 10.5. So Reliance will give him an IP 115.249.131.4. So Reliance will start executing and will start giving him the range of IPs. So let's assume till 10.15, we have got, say, 19 or 18 people have logged on to the Reliance internet connections. Now, the first person who logged on, he suddenly realizes that he has to go for a walk, or he has to go and attend a class or an office meeting or something like that. So what the first person does over here is that he will shut down his computer, and he will also switch off his router. Mind well, shutting down the computer does not necessarily mean that your IP will change. You will have to switch off your router. So he switches off his router and he goes down, or he goes for his meeting. Another person, say 10.16, tries to log on to the Reliance internet. Can admit now, just to make you understand, Reliance has now got two options. He can give IP 2 or he can give IP 19 to the new user. Assuming Reliance gives the IP 2 to the new user, which means this person IP which has shut down has been given to a new user. Now, the person who logged off suddenly realizes or gets a message that a meeting has been cancelled or has been postponed, comes back home. He again tries to switch on to his internet at 10.20. Do you think Reliance will give him the IP 2? Answer is no, because that IP is already allocated to somebody else. He might get an IP, say something like this, which means his IP changed. So every time when your IP changes, that is external IP changes, that is known as a dynamic IP. And every time when your IP does not change, it is known as a static IP. Anyone who is using a CCTV camera or has got a CCTV camera within his office will always be on a static IP. Every website has to be got to be on a static IP. Majority of the servers are on a static IP. To the end users, that is to the retailers, majority of the people are going to be on a dynamic IP. How to find out if our IP is static or dynamic? Just use this who.is on a few periodical days itself and see if your IP changes. And if it changes, you are more or less on dynamic. If it does not, you are more or less on static. Here also you will see that right now we are on static. You can see that RCOM static description over here itself. Now, this is static, this is dynamic. Now we come on to public IP address and private IP address. Now, private IP address, which means this three categories. You can say the examples, this series 10.0.0.0 till 10.255.255.255, and the second series 172.16.0.0 till 172.31.255.255, and the last series 192.168.0.0 till 192.168.255.255. This three range, mind well, the IANA, which I'll be explaining this particular authority, has reserved the following three blocks of the IP address space only for private internet. That is, it can be used only for your LAN networking. This IP will never be used as a part of a public IP. Now, remember this series 10, 172, 192. This is basically used from the point of view of internal LAN networking. So internal, if you see our IP address over here, is in the series of 10.0. series. If you check your own IP, most probably in your home, it will be 192.168.series or it will be 172. But majority of the time, it will be either 10, 172 or 192.168. Now, this is private IP. What do you mean by public IP? Public IP, which means all IP addresses except private IP. So, except for these three, everything else, every other IP becomes nothing but a public IP. So, if you see, this is a public IP address. Within your home, you will check out, this becomes your public IP. I'll just rephrase the entire concept again. Static, which means your public IP never changes, it remains constant. If a public IP keeps on changing, then it is nothing but a dynamic IP. What do you mean by private IP? Just as I said over here itself, you go into Windows, run command, you type the command IP, that is Internet Protocol Configuration, IP config. You press enter, you will see your IP4. This is your private IP, or you can say your internal IP, and your private IP will always be in the range of 10.0.0.2, 10.255.255.255, or 172.16.0.0, 172.31.255.255, or in the range of 192.168.0.0 till 192.168.255. Now, coming to the next part, as I said, internal IP, external IP. Your internal IP is this becomes your internal IP, and this external IP is the public IP which we have just talked about. Now comes the most important part. Right now we are on IP4. So when we talk about an IP4, IP4 addresses are 32 bits, that is 4 bytes in length. It is dotted decimal notification, so we have like 192.149.252.76. Remember, this range will always be between 0 to 255. It will consist, IP4 consists of 4 numbers which are going to be separated by 3 dots. It was deployed in 1981 and it does not support mobile IP. It can be configured either manually or through DHCP, which I'll be covering later on. Now, based on this 32 bits and 4 bytes, when it was deployed in 1981, it was assumed that the number of addresses, which means the number of people that can be connected using IP4, is this range over here. So this much amount of people can actually connect to the internet using our IP4. When this was deployed in 1981, the people who configured or people who programmed this thing, they were under the assumption that given this huge amount of connections, that too way back in 1981, this number of IP or this range of addresses would last for at least 100 years. That is what the notion was, that when IP4 was launched, this number of addresses would actually hold out for 100 years. But came 1999, that is more or less 20 years, and this IP addresses began to dwindle. Lot of people were started getting connected to the internet, and then lot of people required IP. So countries like India, China, and across the world started people using internet, and IP began to less. Now the point was, if they launched IP4, chances are, since the demand was so huge, it might not have been able to survive that particular thing. So they had skipped IP5 and then they directly launched IP6. IP6 is 128 bits. It is 16 bytes in length, so it is almost 4 times. Now this is what an IP6 would consist of. It is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. And it is a hexadecimal notation. Mind well, IP4 is only of 4 digits. It will consist only of numbers, and it is going to be separated by dots. Here, if you see, it is going to be of a, you can say, hexadecimal separated by semicolons, and it consists of numbers as well as alphabets. It was deployed in 1999. It supports mobile IP. It does not require a manual configuration on the DHCP. Now, if you can assume the permutation combinations of IP4 on a 32-bit, this is the number of people that can get connected. Can just assume the permutation combination of this particular IP6. Then if you look at below, the number of addresses, the number of people that can get connected, here is the range over here. See this? You cannot even calculate the number of people that are going to get connected for using IP6. Now, people who have configured IP6, they are now saying that given this huge range, IP6 will last out for at least another 50 to 100 years. This is what again they are saying. So when IP4 was launched in 1981, they said it will last for 100 years. When IP6 is launched, again the same thing has been said, that it will last out for 100 years given this range of IP. Now, just try and see this particular thing, how exactly an IP works. So we have an internet, we have a service provider. Now this can be Reliance, this can be Vodafone, MTNL, BSNL, Tata Docomo. This becomes our public IP. This is connected to our server, or you can say the router. and the router will pass on the internet to our LAN network computers, LAN connected, which will be having different internal IPs. Mind well, the IP address, that is the public IP, would remain the same, but the LAN internal IP address would always be different and could be in the series of, say, 192.168.0, or it could be in the series of 10.0 point something or 172. Your public IP would actually depend on the IP which has been given by the service provider. So here we have an internet passed on to the service provider. Service provider will give us an IP. That IP will be, and we will be having that LAN networking using internal IP addresses. So a command is sent from internal IP to the router or to the server. Server sends it to the service provider. Service provider to the internet. Here is the range, here is the classifications, and here is the private IP address classifications. Now, to understand how do you find out a private IP, simple as I said, going to start, select run, type cmd or type command, and you type IP config. I'll repeat the steps again. Windows R, cmd, and press enter. I'll write the command ipconfig, and if I go on top, there is a IP4 address 10.0.36.22. We need to go on to the very top. We'll see Windows IP configuration and our IP4 address, that is in the range of 10.0.36.22. How to find out the public IP address? Simple, open an Internet Explorer. And there are various options. You go on to Google, you write IP, and it will give us the external IP or IP address. Or you go on to a very popular website known as www.who.is. You press enter, it will give us the IP. You click on that IP, it will give us the details of the service provider over here. Now I can write down any other IP also in this. So I can write 115.249.131. 2 to 5, and I just press enter. So who.is will actually give me the details that this IP address belongs to which service provider. Most probably it should end up turning to be Reliance itself, but basically there are a lot of other websites which will help you to find out. So it is whatismyip.com. We go on to IP who.is. This is how we find out a public IP. Now, how are the IP addresses across the world managed? So, here we have the topmost authority known as IANA, Internet Assigned Numbering Authorities. They are providing IP. They have divided that particular thing into 5 different continents. I'll just take you to the next slide. So, we have Russia, we have Asia Pacific, we have Africa, we have Latin America, and we have America. So, what IANA has done is, this is the main authority which provides IP addresses across the world. They have been distributing it to across 5 continents. So you see this over here, Russia, Asia Pacific, Africa, Latin America, and of course, Britain. I've also given you their website addresses. For those who want to find out into more details, you can visit these websites. These are the nations which have been covered. So green over here, we are coming under Asia Pacific as of now. So basically, IANA distributes this to these 5 different associations. They will pass it on to the service provider, and service provider will pass it on to the user. So assuming we are now using Reliance connections, if we want an additional connection, or if you want to add on to another, we want, say, one more connection. So we'll send the request to the service provider. In our case, it is Reliance Communications. Suppose Reliance Communications says that he is also run out of the IPs, so he will go and approach Asia Pacific, because if you see in the next slide, we have been covered by Asia Pacific over here. Now, if Asia Pacific also says that he has also run out of IP, so he will go and contact the IANA person, association, Internet Assigned Numbering Authorities. They will pass on the IP to Asia Pacific. Asia Pacific will then pass on the IP to the internet service provider. In our case, it is Reliance, and then it will be passed on to the user. This is basically how the IP addresses are being maintained across the world. So just to sum up this particular topic and concept, right now we are on IP4. So range of IP4 is between 0 to 255. It will consist of four numbers which are going to be separated by three dots. The classifications are internal, external, public, private, IP4, IP6, static, dynamic. Static, which means your IP will never change. Dynamic, which means your external IP or your public IP will keep on changing. Public IP is what is known to the people outside. Private, which means our internal LAN networkings. Internal LAN networking will always have in the series of 10, 172 or 192. These are the three series which we are doing. After that, we have an internal IP, external IP, IP4, IP6, and of course, basic functionings of the IP. How do you find out internal IP or a private IP? Simple. Going into run, cmd, type the command ipconfig. Now, ipconfig command is for Windows. If you are using Linux, then the command will change to ifconfig. For those who are using Linux, so maybe Ubuntu or Red Hat or Fedora, so your command would be ifconfig. For Windows, it would be ipconfig, and go on top, here we have an IP4. It is very, very important to understand this particular concept, because later on when we talk about Wi-Fi security or email security, internal IP and external IP is a must. So this is how our private IP is. This is how you find out the public IP and IP addresses, the way that have been managed across the world. Okay, now we start with another very interesting concept, that is Wi-Fi, and we'll be talking about Wi-Fi security. Now, majority of the time, there is a very single or a very popular query, that is, people want to know how many people are actually using their own Wi-Fi. That is, every CA wants to first identify that how many people are connected to their Wi-Fi. When he goes back home, he wants to understand whether somebody is using his home Wi-Fi or not. And this is what I'm going to show you today. That is basically to identify. Now, when we talk about Wi-Fi security, there are various ways to protect your Wi-Fi from getting hacked. Change the router password. Change the encryption to WPA2, PSK, disable the option of broadcast of SSID, add the devices for MAC address filtering. Now, what I'm going to show you is step-by-step phase of how do you secure your Wi-Fi. First, to do that, we actually need to understand what is our default gateway. That is where our router has been actually configured. So we use the command again, ipconfig, and if you see this particular thing over here, we have an IP4, this becomes our internal IP. This is our default gateway. So it is 115.249.131.209. For you, this is what our router IP is. Now, when I talk about this particular thing, change the router password. Majority of the time, you can say 50 to 70% of the people don't even know what their router password is. It is generally set to default password is admin, username is admin, and password is also admin. So just take this IP address over here and we go on to Google Chrome, or we use any of the browser, and we'll put in our default gateway 115.249.131.209. Press enter. Normally, once in your office or when you're at home, you just put in a default IP. It should ask you for two things. That is, it will ask you for a username and it will ask you for a password. Now, majority of the people's username is nothing but admin, and your password will be also nothing but admin itself. So, once you try connecting that particular thing, should, this is what your default gateway would come up to. So when I talk about Wi-Fi security, please change your router password from admin to something else. Better if you can use a special character and make it an 8-digit thing. Right now I'm just trying to connect to the router. Now, most important query. How do you find out how many people are actually connected to your Wi-Fi? For that, we are going to use a software by the name of Netcut. You can write down, this is for people who don't actually know what Netcut is. Just go on to Google and type Netcut. Basically, for those who have understood the concept of internal IP, Netcut, as soon as you start, see, I've already started Netcut over here. Okay, and if you can see, this is my Netcut. I can double click on that. You need to go onto the website, and the name of the software, or this is the website, www.arcai.com, and we are using the latest version. You can see the version over here. Now, what do you mean? What does Netcut basically do? As soon as you install Netcut, you'll see the default IP, that is the gateway IP, which has been shown over here. And here it will show the list of all the IPs, that is the list of all the internal IPs which are connected to this default gateway. And you can see the internal IP addresses which have been given over here. So 10 series, we also have 115 series coming up over here. And we also have the name of the computer which has been connected. And we have the physical address. What do you mean by physical address? It is nothing but the MAC address of that particular computer. Now, so what I'm basically trying to tell you is, on this default gateway, these are the number of people, these are the number of IPs which have been configured. So let's say, I'll just scan the network again, so you can get this particular list. So now, if you are in your office, and if you want to have a little bit of a fun, or if you want to have a mischief, if you have a grudge against any one of your employees, you can download Netcut, install onto your computer, and what you can do is, it will give you a list of all the internal IPs or all the internal IPs that are connected to your network along with their computer name. Any person whom want to have a little bit of a fun or want to do a little bit of mischief on that particular person, what you do is select on that person's internal IP address. You just need to find out the internal IP address of the victim or of the colleague. Click on that IP address and just click on say cut off. Trust me, as soon as you click on cut off, the entire office will be working very, very fine, that it will be able to use the internet, except for the person on whom you clicked and clicked on cutoff. Which means, if there are 10 computers, you clicked on one person's computer, you clicked on cutoff, he will not be able to use the internet. The entire office will be able to use the internet, except for that particular person. It's just for a little bit of fun, you can say that. And after you had your share of fun, you want to resume the person's internet, again click on that particular thing and you click on what? Resume. As soon as you click on resume, the person's internet would be connected again. Basically, as I said, you can use this for fun, you can use it for a little bit of mischief, if you want to take out any grudge on any particular person within your office or within your home itself. So when you go back home, you have your wife's computer, you have your brother's laptop or your sister's mobile, click on that particular IP, click on cut off. Everybody in the home will be able to use the Wi-Fi except for that particular person's device. Mind well, you need to click on resume for it to get started again itself. How do you find out an internal IP of that particular person? This is why I explained the concept of an internet protocol in the first session itself. So once you understand how to take out the IP, click on the IP, click on cutoff, and you can have your share of fun. But mind well, Netcut is basically used from the point of view of security. How and why? As soon as you start Netcut, see, when you go to your office, you would know that there are 10 computers which are connected to your LAN, and maybe you would be using your Wi-Fi onto your mobile devices. So that would be what, 5 or 7 mobile devices. So as soon as you start Netcut, basically what you should see is your 10 computers which are connected to your LAN, and maybe another 5 to 7 computers, 5 to 7 mobile devices which are connected to your Wi-Fi. Give or take, you should see not more than 15 to 16 devices which are connected to your Wi-Fi. But if you see more than 18 or more than 20 devices, which means somebody knows your Wi-Fi password, has already connected to your Wi-Fi and has started using your internet. The same thing you can use when you go back to your home, download this Netcut. And mind well, Netcut, if you download onto Windows, you can use Netcut for Android. You go home, download Netcut. In your home also, you will understand that you will have matched 2 or 3 laptops and 4 or 5 mobile devices. So here the list of people who are connected to your Wi-Fi should not exceed more than 7 or 8. But if you see 10 or 12 people that are connected to your Wi-Fi, or your internal IPs are more than 10 or 12, it is safe to assume that your neighbors know your Wi-Fi password and they've started using your Wi-Fi. So as soon as you see an unknown device connected to your LAN network or to your Wi-Fi, immediately click on that particular thing and click on cut off. So just cut him off from your Wi-Fi thing itself. Click on that and immediately cut him off from your network, and then change your Wi-Fi password. How do you change your Wi-Fi password? For that, you will need to go inside your router and you will see a settings known as changing Wi-Fi settings over there itself. That is the router password and also your Wi-Fi password. So as I said, Netcut is basically used from the point of view of security, and also you can have your own share of fun using Netcut. You can change MAC address, resume, cutoff. These are also the options which are given over here. As soon as you install Netcut, it will be shown at the very bottom of your screen, at the very bottom of your taskbar over here itself. It will be like a scissor kind of an icon over there. And if you want to exit, you can exit from that particular thing itself. So Netcut will not be running. If you want to start again, you want to go into Windows R. I think there will be a desktop icon also which will have been created. So once you download, you see that, double click on that. Please run the Netcut as administrator. So if you get this kind of an error, what you need to do, although Netcut has started, if you're getting this kind of an error, it will take you to the website. You need to go into Netcut. You can say, go into Netcut option, right click over there. Go into properties, you will go to general, you will go to advanced, here you will see that run as network administrator. If you are getting this error continuously, it says unable to manage ARP catch up, please run as administrator. So just need to click on that particular thing. Right click, run as administrator, click on OK, click on apply, OK. And you will have an expert running. Double click on that, click yes. So you no longer get that error over there. See, and this is your internet connection. And you are going to exit from that particular. Now, apart from Netcut, there are various few other software which will be using. That is, another software is known as Who is on my Wi-Fi. Similar software to Netcut, Who is on my Wi-Fi. This also helps you to understand how many people are actually connected to your Wi-Fi. So this is the name of the website, Who is on my Wi-Fi. Once you go onto that website, you will be able to download this particular thing also. It clearly says, easily detect all devices onto your network, runs in the background constantly looking for intruders, be alerted when an unknown device shows up. This is a value add, or this is an extra advantage that you have over a software as Netcut, because who is on my Wi-Fi? Once you connect, once you identify the number of people who are connected, you can save that. See that there's an option known as known, click on known. So anyone else who tries to connect to your Wi-Fi, immediately this software will give you an alert that an unknown computer is trying to connect to your Wi-Fi. Mind well, Netcut is a passive way of finding out if somebody is connected to your network and is trying to use that particular thing. Who is on my Wi-Fi is like an, you can say, an antivirus for your Wi-Fi. Anybody who tries to intrude into your Wi-Fi network, immediately who is on my Wi-Fi will give you an alert and will tell you that some unknown device is trying to connect to your Wi-Fi. Now, this who is on my Wi-Fi, some features are free, some are paid. So for those who are into corporate network security, or those who are really serious about their security, this is what the price range is all about. for those who actually want to start on a just to try to understand the concepts and everything like that. So you can go on to that particular thing for detection, and you can find out and detect the intruders who are trying to come within your network. So these are the two softwares which we are, these are three software which I'm trying to explain. Well, this is Netcut over here. This is a website, www.arci, and you get a lot of tricks and, you know, safety tips of how to use Netcut. What can I do with Netcut? Cut someone off for test for fun, off for bandwidth, and how long shall I wait before I can use Netcut to test cut off, and what is new. So this is basically step-by-step instructions of how to use Netcut over here. And Netcut Defender is what we'll get over here. How to disable, and you'll get a lot of other tricks over here, but our point was to explain how to find out how many people are actually connected to your Wi-Fi. So you can use Netcut, and you can also use who is on my Wi-Fi shop. Now, coming back to the PPT, change the encryption to WPA2 or WPA2 PSK. Generally, people would be using WEP. We just need to go on to WPA2 PSK. Now, this option would be given in your router settings. Once we come to, so I'll just explain how to change the router password. This I'm using 192.168. This is an MTNL router or an MTNL service provider. Username, you need to go over there and change the password. This is the first step of security, that is change your router password. After that, this is where internet wireless connections, you need to see the encryption over here. See, this is where you need to change the encryption authentication type. It should be set to WPA2 PSK. This is the highest level of security as of now. Of course, another level is WPA2 PSK Enterprise, but for a, you can say an office or for a home, WPA2 PSK is sufficient. Here you will see that SSID, that is a broadcasting ID. Now, another step of security is you can disable the option of broadcast of SSID. So over here you will see that broadcast SSID, if you click on no, your SSID will not be broadcasted, and your authentication type should be kept to WPA2 PSK over here. Now, another thing here is what you go is known as MAC filtering over here. See, this option should always be no. Disable the option of broadcast of SSID. MAC filtering, add the devices for MAC filtering, MAC address filtering. But for that, you need to know how many, you need to know the MAC address of that particular computers which are connected to your LAN. How do you find out the MAC ID? Simple, if you use Netcut also, and if you run that particular software, it will give you the physical address over there. Now, MAC address. Basically, what we need to do is we need to find out the MAC addresses of our computers which are connected within our LAN. We can go onto a software that is Netcut over here. You will see the physical address, that is nothing but the MAC address of that particular computer. Find out the number of devices which are connected to your LAN, to your Wi-Fi. Take the MAC address, physical address, put it up inside your router over there, and configure that particular thing. And then you say action as allow. So only this MAC addresses would be allowed to be connected to your Wi-Fi. So the point here is, even if somebody ends up knowing your Wi-Fi password and does try to connect to your Wi-Fi, since his MAC address is not been configured into inside your router, he will not be able to connect to your Wi-Fi. This is one of the best features that a person can use within his office or within his home network. So even if your employee ends up giving the Wi-Fi password to an unknown person or to somebody else, and even if he tries to connect to your Wi-Fi, he will not be able to connect because his MAC address has not been allowed over here. Even if somebody does manage to get connected to your Wi-Fi, you can always use a software known as Who is on my Wi-Fi, which will give you an alert as soon as an unknown device will try to connect to your Wi-Fi. Basically, saving the configuration after doing all this particular thing. So we'll just quickly run the major three steps or four steps of using your, securing your Wi-Fi. Change the router password, change the encryption to WPA2 PSK, disable the option of broadcasting of SSID, and add the devices for MAC address filtering, and use the two softwares, that is Netcut and who is on my Wi-Fi, to find out how many people are actually connected to your Wi-Fi. So this is the PPT. We'll just go through this particular thing. To change your router password, here is the option which has been given. To change your broadcasting ID from yes, you can click on no. And to change your authentication type, here you will get all the options to change your authentication type. You need to disable this particular thing. Authentication type should always be kept to WPA2 PSK. And you need to put in all the MAC addresses of your computers, so no one else can connect to your Wi-Fi. Thank you. Hello everyone. Now we are going to learn a concept known as steganography, which means the art of hiding data behind picture, photo, video files or something like that. So we are going to hide something behind an image. Maybe we can hide a message, we can hide a file. So the user, the other party, would look at the image and he will only be able to see an image, but he will not be able to see the secret message or the file hidden behind that particular thing. So now this concept is known as the concept of steganography. So like anybody in the world who wants to become a hacker come terrorist or a terrorist come hacker, this is the number second concept that a person will need to learn and understand in the field of security or maybe in the field of hacking itself. Worldwide people, worldwide terrorists, a lot of other people who want to hide their data, who want to hide their messages, who want to hide their secret documents, have been using this concept very, very effectively. That is the concept of steganography. There are various tools which will help us to explain this concept. I'm going to use one tool by the name of rSecret, which is an open source tool. It is freely available onto the Google. You can download it and you can search it up onto Google, and you'll find a lot of software which will help you to do this particular hiding the data and everything. So I'm just going to show you how do we use this particular tool. So the name of the tool is rSecret, and there are steps which are written. This is an excellent tool for anybody who wants to learn this concept. So steps are written, we just have to execute these particular steps, and I'll be showing you how to do this particular thing itself. Step 1, say this, select a carrier file. Carrier file, which means what we want to show to the user. We would like to show him the latest iPhone photos, world storage bridge, maybe an income tax document, a return or a challan, or any other thing which will excite the user for him to open that particular file. And as soon as he opens that particular file, for him on the screen, that file will open. But behind that, our virus infected file would go and infect his computer, or something else can go and infect the computer without even the antivirus being able to catch this particular thing. So I'll just show this thing. It says select a carrier file. So I'll just click on that. And we need to choose any of the images which you have onto the computer. Any image would do. So it can be from a sample pictures, you can download an image from the net or anywhere of your choice. So I have an image by the name of Internet IP address. You can see this over here, .jpg. So I'll click open. So an image has opened over there. Now I need to hide data. I need to hide a file, or I need to add a secret data behind this particular image. So what I'll do, see, step 2, self-explanatory software, add or remove. Once I click on add, I see two options. I can add a file or I can add a message. Now if I want to add a file, I would generally select any virus-infected file. Virus-infected file in the sense, for the user, as soon as he clicks on this IP address JPG file, for him that image will open. But behind that, secretly, our virus-infected file would go and reside into the computer. Since I've not shown you or not explained you the concept of how do you create a virus-infected file, like a keylogger or a Trojan or a backdoor, for the sake of convenience, I will select a message, which means now we are going to add a secret message behind this particular file, and I click on next. Now it is going to ask me to click write any subject or any text. So I'll just say, you know, like 5 crore as a subject, and I'll just write, say 5 crore at I see a Dali Bhavan. That would be it. I click on OK. And see that the secret message has come in this particular box. Which means what has now happened here is behind this file, our secret message has been put up. Now, even if somebody comes to know that there is a message hidden behind this particular file, he will not be able to see the message or the file because we are now going to password protect our messages, our message or our file. So here I'm going to put up a password, say 100. I need to put the password twice. The reason why I'm putting the password is to protect the message which is going to be hidden behind that particular image. So what I'll do, I'll put up my password as 100. I'll click on hide. Once I click on hide, the concept of steganography says that you will need to rename this file. You need to save as a different file name. Reason, because you see we have an original file on the desktop. We have tried to alter the original file by putting in a message behind this particular thing, which means we are going to change the size and as well as alter the original file. So what the concept of steganography says is that you rename this file. So I'll say rename this file, I'll say address 123. And I will save it back again on the desktop. I need to save the path again on the desktop. Reason why I am renaming this file is very, very simple. Because I want to make sure that the renamed file contains the message and the original file is left intact. So I'll just click on save. And you'll see on the desktop, another file has been generated by the name of IP address 123. So I'll just open the original file. You can see the image opening over here. I'll minimize this file and I'll open IP address 123. If you can see at the top, but looking at the image of both the files, I really doubt whether anybody will be able to tell me any difference between the two. Like, see, this is the original file. If you can see the name at the very top, and if I open IP address 123, the image remains the same, but there is not a chance that anybody will be able to tell, looking at it directly to the file, that this file actually contains that 5 crore message. Another way of finding out the difference between the two files is that right click, go over there and check the size of the file, properties. We need to look at the bytes, properties. You see a slight variation in both the files. This is 48.7 KB, this is 48.9 KB. Just a little bit of increase. The original file size 48.7, renamed file size 48.9. Reason of this increase is quite obvious. It is because of the message that we have put up behind this particular file. Now, this is the only difference which you can be identifying through this particular thing. But if I have to send you any of these images, there's nobody or very less chance that anybody will be able to detect any message. Another query is that what happens if you open these files through Notepad? So using this Notepad, are we able to find out the difference, or will we be able to find out the message or the password if we try and open this file in Notepad? So just for the sake of satisfying anyone's curiosity, I just open this IP address 123.jpg in a Notepad, and we'll just go through the entire file. We'll just see if we can see the 5 crore, we can see if we can see the password, ICI, Bhavan, any thing that can be identifiable over here. We'll even try to search it up if you want. I'll put the word ICI, not fine. I'll put the password as 100, fine. I'll put CR. Yeah, it says description over there, but apart from that, there's nothing much that can be found out. We're fine. Which means this is so powerful steganograph that even if you try to open this kind of an image in a Notepad, it's not going to open. So we'll just put it back to the normal thing, that is JPEG. And here it is. So across the world, people have been using, in fact, the concept of 9/11, they were also using this. I mean, the 9/11 attacks happened in US steganography concept was very popularly used. Again, in the year 2000 in London, when there was a blast in a subway, they managed to recover one laptop that contained a lot of images. It was so powerfully steganographed that nobody was able to decrypt for the next 2 to 3 years or so. Now, how do you unhide this kind of a file? So what you need to do, specify, go to the other side of the software. There is an unhide option over there. What we say, specify a carrier file. When we say specify a carrier file, the file which we are going to select this time is the renamed file. And we click on open. And we put up the password as 100. I click on unhide, and there it is. I am able to see my entire message over there. I double click on the message, and there is a full description of my message. I will repeat the step again for all of you. I'll close this thing and open it up. How do you hide that? Specify a carrier file. Carrier file can be an image, word, anything. I click on add. I click on message. That is the message which I need to add. I simply write, say 5 crore. ICI. Click on OK. Choose the password as 123. And choose the password as 123. I click on hide. Again, it is going to ask me to rename the file. I'll say 12345 or something. Save it back again on the desktop. Click on save. You see that file has been generated. I'll say open this, choose default program, and this time I can say photo viewer here. Again, really doubt whether anybody will be able to find out any difference or any message behind this particular thing. Check the properties. Again, a slight increase over there. The increase would be on the size of the message that we are going to put up over here. Similarly, since you have hidden this thing, how do you unhide? Coming to the other side of the software, specify a carrier file. We go and select the file which you have recently renamed. Open. Put the password as say 123. Click on unhide. Double click on the message, and we'll be able to see the entire message over there itself. How do you use this concept in a good manner? Well, simple. There are a lot of people who generally have a query that they are not able to remember the passwords. They have Facebook passwords, net banking passwords, Gmail passwords. So a lot of people have a tendency to put all the passwords in an Excel file. And you know, since this has been a very important file, they will give the name of the Excel file as a password file or an important file. So if anybody were to get hands on that particular file, all the passwords would be exposed. So what we generally suggest to all is that you use this concept. You select any of your family images, or you select any image of your choice. You click open, you add, and this time you'll add that Excel file which contains all your password or the text file. You click on next. You have to password over there, then you save it back again on the desktop. Anytime that you want to see your passwords, just go over there, unhide that particular thing, open that particular file, see your message, and that would be the end of it. To the world, try it on the desktop, it will be shown only as an image. Nobody will be able to figure it out that that file contains all your secret messages. So this is the way you can actually use this concept. The software is freely available onto the internet. Software name is rSecret. Use it properly, and this will help you to save a lot of data, a lot of important crucial data for all of you.